Well, at this time, it gives me great pleasure to introduce to you Pastor Richard White. Richard, would you come forward, please?
Well, good morning, EPC. What a joy to be here. Really a joy to be here this year. I have the privilege of being senior pastor of Christ Community Church in Montreat, North Carolina. And we have the huge honor of being home church, stateside church for Andrew and Noreen Brunson, and also Andrew's parents, Ron and Pam Brunson. On Friday, October 7th, 2016, Noreen Brunson sent a very cryptic message to folks in their prayer circles, including Andrew's parents, and there were just four words: "We've been detained, pray." They had just returned to Turkey. They'd been there since 1983 as missionaries. They had just returned, and now they were detained. There had been a coup earlier in the year, year 2016, and they were both detained. Our church thus began that weekend an earnest prayer vigil for them. And in time, this whole ordeal enveloped the EPC and Christians around the world. But for Andrew and Noreen in particular, this was quite an ordeal. Andrew was one of 150,000 people who were rounded up around Turkey and held in prison, and Andrew was held there with no charges initially. Noreen was, after being detained, Noreen was released a few weeks later, several days later, but Andrew remained in prison and was eventually charged with being a terrorist, working with terrorist organizations to overthrow the country. And so thus began a very different ministry for them. And I think one of the questions we've all asked in this is, what is God doing? It's not what was God doing. What is God doing? And Andrew's going to unfold a lot of stuff that's in his heart for Turkey and for the Muslim world. But a very, very different type of ministry began, one they had not anticipated at all. Their names and faces were regularly published in Turkish media as terrorists. Andrew was one of the most hated men in Turkey and endured a harsh prison life for 2 years, and the insane injustice system of that country and the courtroom drama. And just to give you a picture of that, I had the privilege of, there were four trials through the years there, and I was able to attend two of those trials. And just to give you an idea of what that courtroom was like, it was a room larger than this auditorium that we're in, and it was a basketball arena. And the main floor was sectioned off. There was a wooden fence around it. And in the middle of that were about 400 seats, just tightly packed in. And that was for all the prisoners, because there were going to be mass trials of prisoners. So 400 are seated in here, and then cascading up three, four levels on each side were these sections, and there were just rows upon rows of tables with microphones, and that's where the lawyers sat. And so then at the front of this was a huge raised platform so that the judges are looking over this sea of prisoners who would be there. They're on this raised platform. There are three judges, as you're looking to the front, there are three judges on the right, and the prosecutor is on the far left. And they're all raised above you. Andrew is seated down by himself in this 400-seat section, although there were a few others with him, the gendarmes, to make sure he didn't escape. So maybe six, seven gendarmes. But Andrew's by himself with his lawyer 30 feet away, at a table with a microphone. They cannot communicate. And at every trial, there's a tiny bleacher section in the way back And that's where Noreen and some faithful Christians, a lot of reporters, and that's where I was able to as well join with Noreen, seated for the two trials I attended. But Andrew is there by himself. And in the front, behind the judges, are two Jumbotron screens where witnesses with voices and faces disfigured and scrambled give hours and hours of false testimony against Andrew. And I hope he'll share with us some of the insanity of the lies that were being used as evidence for why he was a terrorist. It was stated by several people, not just us, but dignitaries, lawmakers from our country who visited, that this was a kangaroo court, to which one of our elders said, "That is an insult to kangaroos everywhere." It was amazing watching Andrew in action, speaking in fluent Turkish, having to defend himself, and watching really the power of the Lord fill this man and giving him opportunity to give a defense for the reason he was there, and that's the gospel of Jesus Christ. On Friday, October 12th, 2018, although convicted as a terrorist, Andrew was released to travel, and he and Noreen left the country that night, and the next day they were kneeling in the Oval Office praying for the president. Psalm 126 says this: "When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dreamed. Our mouths were filled with laughter, our tongues with songs of joy. Then it was said among the nations, 'The Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us.' And we are filled with joy." This was the theme of our celebration service in late October when Andrew and Noreen were finally able to join us in Montreat and to celebrate God's goodness and mercy to us. Last year, we had the privilege of having Andrew's daughter address the assembly. But this year, our mouths are filled with laughter and our hearts with great joy as we welcome Andrew and Noreen home. Andrew, we welcome you, brother.
Thank you. We're so very grateful to the EPC. What can we say? Thank you so much. We're so grateful to Jeff Jeremiah. Somehow the Lord put us on his heart, and he carried a great burden, and we're so grateful for all that he did. I don't know that there's anyone who fought more for us than Jeff did. We're very grateful to him.
Yeah.
And we're grateful to all of you who prayed for us. I think there was an unprecedented prayer movement. This was not something that just happened because of networks talking to each other and passing on a prayer request. It was something that we see that really was God initiated and God sustained. We find out the number of people who prayed is astounding. And then the length of time for which they prayed, the duration. One of the great fears I had is that people would start praying for me, but then they'd move on to the next crisis because, you know, to pray for 2 years is a long time. And I kept asking Noreen when she would visit me. It was the one contact I had with the outside world. I had a weekly visit with her. In the first prison I was in, it was about 35 minutes. We'd speak through reinforced glass and on telephones. In the second prison, I thought I'd gone to heaven because I got a whole hour with her a week, again, through the reinforced glass. But I'd ask her, are people still praying for me? And she would say, yes, actually, it's growing. It hasn't stopped. And this was an amazing thing to me because how could people keep praying? There are so many other things to pray for. And then the intensity with which many prayed. A number of people said they'd wake up in the middle of the night and pray for me, and I thought, I don't do that for anybody. And then the geographical distribution, just how many countries, churches in so many countries around the world were praying for me. Someone told me at the national prayer breakfast, I was in a group, explaining what had happened with us, a prayer movement that had started. And he said, well, we just need to do this more often for things. And I thought, you know, I said, I don't think you're going to see this replicated very easily. This was very, very unusual. I was with Timothy George last week. He's a church historian. And he said that he doesn't think there's been such a large prayer movement centered on one person since World War II, and the person he mentioned that people were praying for in World War II, I haven't heard of personally. So I think it may go back much further than that to see this large a prayer movement for centered on one person. And it just underlines how clearly this was a move of God. It was something, again, that God initiated, God started it. God somehow put me on many people's hearts in an unusual way. And then he sustained that. And there's a reason why he did this. I think that he could have released me at a number of points. Actually, there were agreements that were made between the U.S. and the Turkish government. There were a number of times that it seemed it was very close. A release was very possible. And then it was broken. The agreements were broken by Turkey every time. But I think God was keeping me in there for a purpose, which was, maybe there were several purposes, but at least one of them was to grow this prayer movement. And there's a reason for this. Is in 2009, the Lord had spoken to me, and he said, prepare for harvest. I was surprised when I heard this. I hadn't expected this. Turkey is the largest unevangelized country in the world, this very small church. There are about 5,000 or 6,000 believers out of 83 million Turks. Many cities do not have a missionary or a church at all. Many of them don't have any believers. Most Turks have never met a Christian. So I thought, how can we be expecting a big harvest here? Usually when there's a harvest in a place, there's, as I look at the history of missions, there's been a long period of sowing for many, many times for decades. So I thought, how can we expect a harvest here? But then the Lord spoke again to me, prepare for harvest, and he confirmed this, and this began to grow in my heart. Then we began to move in a different way. The Lord began to give us assignments in how we could prepare for harvest, starting House of Prayer, starting some training programs, different things like that. So Satan wanted to knock us out. I know that he not wanted to knock Noreen and me out, but God is a grandmaster chess player. It's the way that we thought of it. And I think at some point, I say around the 18-month mark, I don't know, but I think how I've imagined it, visualized it, is that one day Satan just suddenly realized, oh no, God has outmaneuvered me again. Because when he started, I think he intended to knock Noreen and me out, which shouldn't be that difficult to do. But God began to raise up a prayer movement. His sons and daughters around the world began praying, and it just grew and grew and grew. And I think at some point, Satan suddenly realized, oh no, what have I done? This is one of the major dark principalities, dark powers in the world, spiritual powers. Turkey was ahead of the Ottoman Empire, which means they were the head of the Muslim world for centuries. They conquered many lands, they imposed Islam, they suffocated Christianity. And so they have a very dark inheritance. And I thought, I don't think Satan would have done this if he knew what the results would be. Because suddenly there are millions of people around the world, the sons and daughters of God, who are praying, pouring their prayers into one of these very dark places. And there's this confrontation that God maneuvered, that God planned between his children and this very dark area. So I say I rode a wave of prayer out of Turkey, but I think a tsunami of prayer has crashed into Turkey. And we're going to see the results of this. I became aware as my imprisonment continued, and I'm saying, Lord, am I ever going to get out of here? Are you going to take me out? What are you doing anything with this? It helps if there's a sense of purpose in persecution. And as we became more and more aware over time of how this prayer movement was growing, I came to see that what we'd received as an assignment in 2009, prepare for harvest, that this was part of the assignment. That my imprisonment was actually preparing for harvest in Turkey. This many people have never prayed for Turkey. Many people who've never heard of it, never looked it up on the map, don't know where it is, have prayed for Turkey. Because God plans to bring a great harvest in that place. I believe that millions will come to him. I believe I'll see it in my lifetime, and I believe that it will spread from there to other places in the region. So I think as you look back on this, and yes, I'm a visible answer to prayer. God doesn't always answer in this way. I'm glad he did for me. I'm a visible answer to prayer, but I think we're going to see, you will see, someday that you are involved in something much bigger than my being released, but in a movement that's going to transform that region. Sometimes I've thought of it as a puzzle, looking at a puzzle from the bottom. You don't really see all the things. At some point, we're going to look at the puzzle from the top. We're going to see all the things that God wove together. Right now, we only see part of it. In 2007, I began to run after God in a new way. I'd already been in ministry for a number of years in Turkey. We'd already been involved in church plants, but I became hungry for more of God. And no matter how long you've been walking with the Lord, how old you are, how many experiences you've had with him, how deep your walk is with him, there's always more. There's always more of God. There's always deeper that you can go in him. So I began to pray at that time. I wanted more power of the Holy Spirit. I wanted to see gifts. I wanted to see anointings. I wanted to see God's glory. And I began to pray, but in a better than I knew. I said, Lord, draw me so close to your heart that you'll be able to trust me with the authority required to start waves, spiritual waves. What I needed wasn't to go after power of Holy Spirit. I needed to go after the presence and intimacy with him. And I was praying better than I knew, because this is really what I needed. And I just went after that. I started to go after it, saying, Lord, draw me close to your heart. I want more of you. I want to taste your glory. I want to see you. I want to know your presence in ways that I haven't before. Draw me close. Let me know you. Let me know you in a deeper way. So I began to pray for this intimacy. I began to go after the presence of God. And there are different degrees, different levels in which God shows his presence, in which we experience him. And in one sense, God is everywhere. We say he's omnipresent. We experience him at one level in that way. Then we say that he's present in a different way. When two or three believers are gathered together, Jesus said, I'm in the midst of them. There's a different way in which I experience him because he's present in me, as in the believer, through the Holy Spirit. And then there are times when he also shows his presence in a way that we can sense. He gives signs of his presence. And one of those examples would be Solomon's temple at the dedication. God's presence descended as a cloud, and it was so overwhelming, the glory of God, so heavy on the priests that they couldn't stand. And this was a demonstration that they could feel, that they could experience. And I said, Lord, I would love for a cloud to descend in my church. I would love for your glory to descend on us. I want to know you and experience you in this way, the way that Moses did when he saw your glory. And we began to spend a lot of time seeking God. And I wanted to become hungry, to become thirsty, and I started to pray for this. Lord, make me hungry for you. Make me hungry for you. Sometimes people ask me, well, how can you love God more? I say, well, tell him. Tell him that you want more. Ask him to make you hungry. That's a great gift because it makes us run after him. So I began to hunger to experience God's glory, to taste his presence. And he began to give signs of his presence. People began to be healed in our church. We began to hear his voice. Many Muslims began to, many of them have dreams and visions, and this is the way they come to faith. Almost every Muslim believer in Turkey that I've talked with either had a dream that started them on their search, or after they started searching, they had a dream that confirmed it. So this is how God moves with many of them. So this is what we were after. We were involved in a number of ministries. We'd been, you know, whether it was church planting, house of prayer, training, working with refugees, and all of them, our focus, whatever we were doing, it was to seek God's presence, to seek intimacy with him. So now I want to jump over to my imprisonment, and I'll make the connection with this search for intimacy a bit later. And some people have told me, God loved you so much that he kept you in prison for 2 years where you could be alone with him. No. So it's just you and God, Andrew. This is going to be a great time. Yeah, so it sounds wonderful. But let me tell you what really happened. So Noreen and I were arrested, held together for 2 weeks. After this, she was released, but the Turkish government kept me for another 2 years. Usually says she's so far ahead of me. You know, she got out in 13 days. God needed to work another 2 years on me. Then they moved me to a detention center, and I was kept in solitary confinement for 50 days. By the way, Richard said, you know, 150,000 people caught up, and at first, I think the U.S. government thought that I was just caught up. Somehow there was a mistake, and I was caught up with a lot of other people. That wasn't the case. I was very specifically targeted. Interestingly, the United Nations Working Group on Arbitrary Detention took up my case. They take up about 30 a year, and they determined that I was targeted by the Turkish government for my faith, which I'm surprised the UN would come to that conclusion, but they did. So it was very clear that it wasn't just a mistake. They put me in solitary for 50 days. That's very difficult. And I was afraid. I knew that there was a very powerful spirit behind this. I remember the day it just kind of dawned on me suddenly, you know, the Ottoman Empire, they suffocated Christianity. And this same spirit is behind the, you know, Paul talks about how our battle is not against flesh and blood. There are spiritual powers and principalities. And I thought, I'm in the hands of a very, very dark, powerful one. And it was very scary. So I was alone. I was locked in a room with just a bed. It was me in a bed. I had no books. I had nothing to write with. I had nothing to do except pace back and forth with tremendous stress, anxiety, a lot of fear. So in that first week in solitary, I was very afraid. I was torn up, but at the same time, I had a sense of God's presence. And this was a comfort to me in the midst of all the fear I had. And I thought at the time, if I were to write a book, I would give it the title, Presence, the Fundamental Need. Because this is what I'd run after for years. I thought, here in prison, here in this solitary confinement, where I'm so full of fear, yet I still feel God's presence. I can sense him. And this gives me strength. I thought that's what it would be like the rest of the time I was there. But over the next few days, I completely lost the sense of God's presence. God was silent. And he remained silent for 2 years. And this really surprised me. I was so desperate for his touch, but I had no sense of his presence. And I don't mean emotions by this. I mean every way in which I'd experienced him before, in my spirit or physically or an awareness of him. None of the ways that I'd experienced him before. And I didn't see any evidence of his presence either in practical ways. And I cried out in anguish, but it was like crying out to a wall. In fact, I yelled internally. I said, I may as well speak to this wall, because that's what it's like talking to you. There's no response. I felt completely abandoned. And this terrible silence, this isolation, it continued throughout the rest of my imprisonment. I was transferred then to a high security prison. I was kept in a cell. It was a cell for 8 people, but there were over 20 of us in it. And they were all very strong Muslims. They were all accused of being part of the Gulenist movement, which is really an Islamist missionary movement. So they were very committed Muslims. And they could not understand my doubts, my questions, my anguish, my cries to God. And this is because I had a very different expectation than they did for my relationship with God. This comes from the Bible. God describes himself as Father. And I'm his son. And God describes himself also as a jealous husband. And I'm the object of his passion. I'm the bride. All of you strong men, think of yourselves as a bride. Yeah. I'm the bride. He's passionate about me. He loves me. And he's the one who described himself in this way so that we can understand his passion and love for us. The love of a father, the love of a husband. And I thought, what kind of father, if his son is crying out to him, remains silent? I think of my sons. I have 2 sons, Jordan and Blaze. And if they were in pain and fear and cried out to me, even if I couldn't help them, I would at least answer them, I'm here, I'm here. Or a husband. I think of myself as a husband, if Noreen were in pain, would I not answer? There's nothing that makes me more angry than thinking that someone's hurting my wife. So I had the expectation of a son. I had the expectation of a beloved bride, and I couldn't understand the distance and the silence of my beloved. So my great grief came from being separated from Noreen. She's my closest friend. I had deep grief over fear also of not seeing my children again. I wept bitterly. I cried more in my first year in prison than I did in my previous 48 years combined. But it's not this grief that caused a crisis of faith for me. I don't like persecution. I don't know why God doesn't intervene more forcefully, more quickly, more decisively. But I do know that it's something that we should expect, persecution. Jesus said it would happen. It's a possibility for God's children. But so I understood what was happening to me. I understood why I was in prison. It was persecution. The crisis, what broke my heart towards God, was feeling abandoned by him. It wasn't being in prison. It was being in prison, but thinking, God, you've abandoned me in prison. I became so weary, so tired of fighting. And I wanted to be done. I wanted to go to heaven. I struggled with suicide a number of times. I thought I'd much rather be in heaven than spend the rest of my life in a Turkish prison, isolated in this way. And I called out, I accused God. I said, now, when I'm walking in the valley of death, in my desperation, this is the darkest time of my life, and I remind you, God, I'm suffering because of Jesus. I'm suffering because of you for your sake. Where are you now? Where are you in the hardest time of my life? I said, God, are you just the God of conferences? You show up when everything's good and we're all together and singing, and what about in the darkest, hardest times? This is when I really need you. What kind of father are you? What kind of lover are you? Don't worry, it does end well, the story. I wasn't prepared for what I faced. I thought I was tough. In some ways, I was. I'd been through difficulties. I'd placed myself in danger a number of times. I was shot at once. I experienced betrayals. Noreen and I spent time near a war zone where there was risk. We pressed on for 23 years in Turkey. I was a seasoned missionary, but prison was beyond my strength, and I thoroughly broke, repeatedly too. God did bring me through. The first year I was broken. I think of the second year especially as a time when he rebuilt me. I want to focus on one of the things that I learned. For me, in prison, the fundamental thing, the most necessary thing, I found out was not a sense of God's presence. And I don't want to give the wrong message. I'm still a man who's running after God's presence. That's what I most want. But the fundamental thing, what was required of me, was a simple devotion, a simple faithfulness, a simple love on my part. I was stripped of brothers and sisters, of fellowship. I didn't have other believers to encourage me. The only contact I had was what I mentioned before, Noreen, who I'd see for only a very short time every week through reinforced glass. This was it. I was stripped of also the refreshment of and warmth of sensing God's presence. And all that was left was a core of love in my heart, a simple devotion that I clung to in desperation. The prison biographies I'd read, they didn't prepare me for what I faced, for the struggle I had in prison. I had an idealized, romantic view of suffering. I was sure that I'd be filled with joy. And I think many other people were also, because they would write to me and say, remember Paul and Silas. Do what Paul and Silas did and just sing. Well, I'm a little cynical there because I'd say, well, they were only in prison for one night. But I expected that I'd be filled with joy. After all, I'm suffering for Jesus. Paul seemed to be filled with joy. I did expect grief, but I also expected that I would have a sense of strength. I expected a sense of grace. And I've read of prisoners who had encounters with Jesus in their prison cells, or they had an angel appear to them and strengthen them, or they heard the audible voice of God, and I thought, well, this is a time when maybe I'll have an encounter with God. But it didn't happen. I kept asking for it, and it didn't happen. And what I've actually heard after getting out of prison is that many others, there are very few Westerners who've been imprisoned for their faith, but many who have been in other countries, that they actually had an experience similar to mine. They occasionally had a bit of light, but it's rare. Most of the time, they experience a silence of God. They have a sense of abandonment. I still don't understand this, but it's what many experience. And it doesn't only happen to people who are being persecuted. I met a pastor a few months ago whose wife spent close to 4 years in bed after a routine surgery that just went wrong. And she was so debilitated and in such pain, she could not get out of her bed for 4 years. And actually, that pain has continued for another 10 years. During those 4 years, his wife had no sense of the presence of God, and she wanted to die. She felt abandoned by God. And why? Where is the lover of the soul, of my soul in the dark night? Why, although he's present? Because we know he's present. But why, when he's present, does he not let me be aware of his presence? Why doesn't he let me sense his presence? Where is the comfort? Where are the loving arms? I don't know. I don't know the answers. And I realize those are my questions. Why? Where are you? And I ask them so many times. Where are you? Why? But then it occurred to me that God also has a question for me. I'm always thinking of my questions and never of God's questions for me. But God had a question for me. Andrew, will you be offended? Will you continue to love me? Will you devote your heart to me? Will you pass the test? And here's the truth. God does test his sons and daughters. I'm not saying that God does evil, that he's a source of our hardships. He's certainly not out to get us. But in the midst of our hardships, he does test us. And God gives difficult assignments to his children. Ones that he knows can be very painful. And these can stretch us beyond what we could have expected. Think of the people you most admire in the Bible. Just take 5 seconds and can I have some names? Who are the people you admire in the Bible? Joseph, okay. Someone else? Paul? Job, okay. John, okay. Moses? These are on my list too. Moses, Abraham, Joseph, David. And now think about what they went through. We admire them. Think about what they went through. I think of Moses. He's highly trained. He's in the most advanced, powerful country in the world of that time, in Egypt. And he's trained in the best military, culture, science. And he thinks he's going to save his people. And then he takes a step of faith, and God doesn't show up. And he has to flee from Egypt. And he ends up, having been at the pinnacle of power, he ends up herding goats and sheep in the wilderness for 40 years. And he doesn't know that God is going to show up after 40 years and that then Moses is going to become the person that we all admire, the Moses that we know. He doesn't know that while he's out herding the goats and sheep. You think of Joseph, we all know how he spent time in prison. He didn't know when he was going to get out. He couldn't be sure, and it extended for years. And I think of David, who receives the prophecy from Samuel, the kingship prophecy, and then everything goes wrong, and he's waiting for years, and he's hiding out in a cave. And I'm sure that these guys struggled, because the heart of man is the same. It was the same then as it is now, and we would have struggled in those circumstances. And I think, just think, these are God's friends. Look how he treated them. But maybe this is how they became God's friends. Almost all of God's friends that we see in the Bible, almost all of them had a time of testing when answers were delayed, a time when they felt abandoned, when they experienced the silence of God. And when God took them into those tests, he knew that they were going to struggle. It wasn't a surprise to God. He knew it would be very difficult, but he did it anyway. He exposed them to hardship. He put them at risk. He did it knowingly. And they made it through. They were faithful. They didn't turn away in offense. And they emerged from that testing as proven. And then they were called friends of God. There are many who go into the valley of testing, and some do not survive. This really hit me around the 9-month mark in prison. I'd lost about 50 pounds. I was suicidal. I was totally broken. And somehow in the past, I thought, I think many of us do, that God will not ever give us something that we cannot overcome. That we're going to somehow be victorious at the end of as we go through every test and emerge victorious from it. But this isn't always true. I was reading a book about this valley of testing and how there are many skeletons, there are many dry bones in the valley of testing. And this is from people who've gone in, believers who have failed in their test.
The valley of testing is full of dry bones. Not everyone makes it out. Many are knocked out of ministry. There are many pastors, I'm sure you're aware, who are knocked out of ministry, and many are knocked out of their friendship with God, even if they continue in ministry. And these people may end up in heaven. That's not the issue here. The issue is that they miss out on the victories that God had planned for them to win. They miss out on the inheritance that God had planned for them. So there's an intimacy. There's a depth of friendship with God that only comes with testing. So I ran after intimacy with God for years. And then I had 2 years of silence. And I actually found out that that took me into a deeper intimacy at the end. There's an intimacy, a depth of friendship that only comes with testing, because untested love, untested devotion, and untested loyalty is unproven. And my love can be completely sincere, completely real, but until it's been proven, well, it hasn't been proven. What I've read about soldiers is that they train for battle, but until they've actually been in a battle, there's something missing. They have it in theory, but after they've been in a battle, they come out tested. There's something different about them. So there's a gift that God gave me, a result of my testing, is that he showed me my heart. And often when we talk about God showing us our heart, it's, oh no, he's going to show me my heart. It's full of sin. It's terrible. But there are actually many good things that God sees in our hearts. And he gave me a gift in showing my heart to me. After 18 months in prison, the Turkish government finally decided to put me on trial. And Richard was describing what that was like. A day before my trial started, I was moved back to my old prison. And the trial was going to take place in my old prison. And this was very traumatic for me because I had broken very badly in that prison. I'd had a very difficult time. So when they returned me to that place, it triggered all that trauma again. All the progress I'd made, I'd been pressing into God. Around the one-year mark, I decided I was going to run after him. I'll talk more about that tomorrow. And just pressing into him, and all the progress I'd made in God rebuilding me, it's almost like it vanished, and I was crushed again. I was put into a solitary cell in the other solitary cells in my row. We could communicate by yelling out our windows. Generals who were accused of leading the coup were my neighbors. So I was in with the really heavy hitters there. On my trial day, I was exhausted. I hadn't slept for 2 days. I couldn't eat. By that time, I was using anti-anxiety meds because my body had just completely worn out from the stress and anxiety. And I didn't receive my medications, so I was really anxious. Then I stood alone in court for 13 hours before hostile judges and the prosecutor. And I also had this terrible stress that went with it because I was falsely accused of terror crimes. I knew that it didn't matter what kind of defense I made, that it wouldn't make any difference because this was a completely political case, and they wanted to put me in prison for 35 years. And 35 years is a long time. So I was afraid. And I was also told that I would be kept in solitary confinement in this very harsh prison for the remainder of my trial. And in Turkey, the trials can go on for 2, 3, 4 years. I thought, how can I handle this? It was overwhelming to me. So I was devastated physically and emotionally. I was broken. And I lay there in my solitary cell alone, isolated under this very heavy, dark weight of fear and terrible grief. And just this grief and fear welled up inside of me, and I was weeping, lying on my bed. And the thought, the prayer kept going through my mind. Where are you, God? Where are you? Why have you permitted them to return me to this terrible place? Why haven't you intervened for me? Why are you so far away? Why are you so silent? If I have to go through this, can't you at least give me your presence? Where are you? And I open my mouth and I'm weeping aloud. And I was surprised by the words I heard come out of my mouth. I said, "I love you, Jesus." And I'm weeping and I'm saying, "I love you, Jesus." I've been saying, "Where are you, God? Why have you abandoned me?" But what's coming out of my mouth is, "I love you, Jesus." And I suddenly realized, wait, here's my victory. Here's my victory. Yes, I do love you. Even if you're silent, I love you. Even if you allow my enemy to hurt me, I love you. Even if you don't give me your presence, I love you. So I was full of fear and grief, but then I felt this sense of victory. My heart has been tested. My love has been tested. And yes, in my hardest time, in my deepest fear, yes, what comes out of my heart is that I love you. And somebody told me, "Andrew, you passed the test of betrayal. You didn't betray Jesus." So I say, God showed me my heart, and it was a gift to me. So I did question God. I had many doubts. But God's faithfulness, God's love, and his loyalty were never being tested. They never are. It was my faithfulness. It was my love and my loyalty that were being tested. The question was, would I pass the test of God's silence? Would I betray when I felt betrayed by God? And there's a test of isolation, of abandonment, of being alone with no support. The test of there's grace, but it's unfelt. Test of weakness, of brokenness, and the test of doubts. So I proved my love for God. I was certainly weak and broken. And without his grace, I wouldn't have made it through. But in my worst time, when I felt abandoned and alone, and when God was silent, my cry was, "I love you, God. I love you, Jesus." And this is precious. It's certainly precious to God. I say, God may know the results of our testing. He may have known that I would remain faithful, that I would love him. But until I actually went through the test, I hadn't proven this. So my test and my victory are precious to God. And it's also precious to me because he showed me my heart and now I know. And I know that he knows that I really do love him. And this gives me a confidence in my relationship with God. I paid a price for it. It was costly. But I gained a new measure of intimacy with him. And I know that Jesus trusts me at a different level now. So my tests aren't over. I'm really unhappy when I see that my mentors who are now in their 70s and 80s are still having struggles in ministry. So it continues on until we get to heaven. So I know that my tests aren't over, and certainly tests are coming your way. Sometimes people would tell me, "Well, Andrew, you have such a difficult ministry. You're working in Turkey. It's really hard to work there. It's not like the kind of work I do." And I never liked hearing this because it's true some people's ministries are more difficult than others. Some assignments are more difficult than others. But we each have our front lines that we're assigned to. We each have our front line, and our front line is our battle line. The heart of man is the same everywhere. So our difficulties may be different, but the same things are being tested in our hearts. We're being tested in the same areas. And I'm sure some of you are experiencing hardship. I can't remember the exact percentage, but Jeff told me that a third to half of the people who will be here today, he said, are hurting. Maybe there's an illness. Maybe there's a problem in your family. Maybe you've gone through some betrayal. Maybe something bad has happened to you, to someone you love. And the hardships you go through, they will test your devotion to God. They will test you. And some of you, I am sure, are wondering, where is my God? Where is Jesus? Where is my shepherd? Where is the lover of my soul? God, why are you silent during my most difficult time? Why haven't you intervened? You've gone into the valley of testing. And this is agonizing, it's painful. And I don't know the answers. I don't know the answers. But getting the answers does not matter nearly as much as avoiding the offense, as avoiding becoming offended at God. Can you give up demanding the answers? Because the most important thing is that you have to survive the test. You have to survive the test. I started to pray desperately in prison when I became aware of this valley of testing full of bones. I said, Lord, I don't want to end up a skeleton in the valley of testing. I want to survive my tests. So don't lose your battle in the valley of testing. Don't lose the inheritance God has planned for you. You must not become offended. And if you are offended, and I am sure that a number of you carry offense in your heart towards God, a hurt, a pain. If you are offended, you must not stay offended. You must hold on to Him. You must connect your heart to Him. The cry of your heart has to be, I love you, Jesus. I love you even in your silence. I love you even in my aloneness. I love you even in the darkness. I have a sense of urgency for this generation, for the next generation and for mine. I think it's going to become much more costly to follow Jesus, to stand for Him. I'm going to speak about that tomorrow night. And in the United States, it may not be a prison, but it can mean being marginalized, shamed publicly, and all that comes from this. You stand for Jesus, you're going to face opposition. And evil and darkness, I think we all have a sense that it's increasing. We're aware of this. It's going to become more intense. And this shouldn't be a surprise because Jesus said very clearly that as His return draws near, that darkness is going to increase and there will be persecution. The Bible, I think, also shows that there will be a great move of God, powerful move of God at the same time, but it will be in difficult circumstances. So my urgency comes from thinking that many of us are not prepared for what's coming. And if you're not prepared, Jesus warned that many will be surprised. And if you're not prepared, if you don't have the right mentality and you're surprised by it, well, this is very dangerous. And many, Jesus said, are going to be offended. They're going to be offended by what God allows to happen. They're going to be offended that God does not intervene. And they will blame Him for many things and turn away. And many believers are going to be offended because in the darkness, in their difficulties, they will think that God has abandoned them. It isn't so, but many are going to think that. And they will be so disappointed that their hearts will become cold. So you need to make a decision now that this will not be you, that you won't allow this to happen to you. Now is the time to cultivate devotion to God that will enable you to stand in the most difficult times. If I'd known that I would only be in prison for 2 years, I would have just held on, gripped my teeth, hold on for 2 years. Prison would not be easy, but at least I would know it was going to end. But I didn't know. At one point, the Turkish government wanted 3 life sentences for me, 3 life sentences in solitary confinement with no possibility of parole. And I thought, I'll never see my wife again, I'll never see my children again. I didn't know how things were going to turn out. And this was a really difficult thing, not knowing what's going to happen. The uncertainty. So in your own struggles and your challenges right now, that's the difficult thing a lot of times, is not knowing what's going to happen. How will things turn out? Will this end? Will this trial end? Will this difficulty end? And we have to hold on. And we have to endure. We need to cultivate this endurance, and it doesn't just happen automatically. You have to go after it. You have to make a decision day after day. I will be faithful. I will devote my heart to you, Jesus. My theme verse became Isaiah 50:10. During my time in prison, I read this so often. And God says, let him who walks in darkness and has no light. Trust in the name of his God and lean on him. Let him who walks in darkness and has no light. What's interesting to me about this verse is that God is saying this to people who are in darkness because he put them into darkness. He's speaking to the exiles. So God put them into darkness, and he could remove them from this darkness, but he doesn't. Instead, he says, lean in, grab on to me, trust in my name. Lean in and grab on, hold on, don't let go when you're in the darkness. That's what I was learning in prison. How to stand in the dark. How to walk in the darkness. How to lean into my beloved. Some of you feel like you're walking in darkness now. Some of you have already been through dark times, and there's still that offense where you're hurt toward God. Some of you, I'm sure, need to renew your love for Jesus and your devotion to him. And it doesn't happen automatically. It won't happen if you wait. It doesn't happen with time. You have to go after it. You need to cultivate it. And some of you need to renew your decision that you're going to go after God. You're going to go after loving him. That you want that friendship with him, and you ran after it before and it's just kind of died down, grown cold a bit. Maybe your heart has grown cold. Maybe it never was your priority to run after God, or it was and you lost it. Different experiences in this room. And I want to encourage you now to take that step, to say, I'm going to lay down my offense. I'll lay down my disappointment. I'll lay down my hurts and embrace you, God. I don't have to understand. I had so many doubts and questions, and I found that they were suffocating my relationship with God. I couldn't receive. I'd read the Bible, and I'd read verses that should have spoken to me, and I'd say, yes, yeah, but, yes, but. Or Noreen would come, and she had to bring truth to me every week and speak to me and try to correct some of my wrong thinking. And she would speak truth to me, and I couldn't receive it because of all my questions and doubts. So I'd always respond with that, yes, but this doesn't apply to me. And I found that my doubts and questions were suffocating my relationship with God. One day, I imagined a lockbox. And I opened that lockbox, and I took my questions and my doubts, and I said, God, I'm putting them in this box. I'm locking them away. Then I closed that door, and I turned the lock. And this is a very high-tech box. I imagine it in my mind. So it reads the palm print, right? And I said, God, you and I are the only ones who can open this. You can open it anytime you want, but I've made a decision. I will not open this box. I will not entertain these questions. I will not let them take root in my mind. I will not open this box. I'll wait until the time that you are ready to deal with my heart. But until then, I will not open it. I do not need to have the answers to have a relationship with you. And this changed the rest of my time in prison. Whenever I had these questions and doubts come back, and they did, and I had reasons to have them, I'd say, no. They're in the, you stay in the box. Whatever it is you have in your heart now, whatever questions and doubts that you have, lock them away now. Lock them away. Say, God, I'm going to lay down my offense. I'm going to embrace you. I want a new beginning. Refresh me. In my darkness, I need to lean on you. In my darkness, I need to know your presence. When I stand before Jesus at the end of my life, and this is what I try to live for, this is what I keep my eyes on, I don't think he's going to ask me, Andrew, how many churches did you plant? How many places did you speak? How many people admired you? I think you'll evaluate me based on one thing, and that's my heart response to him. Did you love me, Andrew? Were you faithful to me? Did you tie your heart to mine? If you've been offended towards God and you need to lay it down, or if you need to say, Lord, my love has grown cold, I need to be renewed. I want to go after you. I need a fresh start with you. Then I invite you to stand. I believe that God will honor this step on your part. So I invite you to stand if you need to do this, as a solemn step before God. And I'm not asking everyone to stand. This is between you and God. Going to pray. You take whatever you want from my prayer and pray your own prayer. Holy Spirit, we welcome you in this room. Jesus, I want to renew my love for you. I want to renew a simple devotion to you, O God. Oh, Holy Spirit, I ask you to pour out healing in this room now. Pour out healing on your sons and daughters, oh Father. Heal wounds. Heal brokenness. Heal doubts. Do what only you can do, Holy Spirit, and repair our hearts. Heal the rift that is opened up between you and some of your precious sons and daughters, oh Father. Oh, that you would blow through this place, Holy Spirit. Oh Father, I want to be yours. I want to be your faithful son. I want to love you. I want to love you, Jesus, with all that I have. Capture my heart completely. Capture my heart. I don't want to be offended by what I don't understand. I don't want to hold offense. I don't want to hold brokenness in my heart towards you. So I say, here's my wounded, broken heart. I give it to you. And I look to you, the lover of my soul. Father, for everyone who stood to seek you, who's seeking healing of the heart, who's standing to lay down offense, to renew their commitment to love. Lord, I ask for an impartation for intimacy. Holy Spirit, just kindle a fire in our hearts. Let us burn for you. I ask for the gift of hunger and thirst after you. Lord, pour it out on us. For everyone who's taken that step right now, standing before you, this solemn step, Lord, I ask that you pour it out. Renew. Renew passion. Renew intimacy. Impart to us the fire of love. May it burn in our hearts and never go out. Start a fire in us that will never go out.
Holy Spirit, reveal the love of Father and Jesus for us. And may this powerful, fiery love spring up in us. I bless my brothers and sisters, Father. We want more of you. We want to be faithful. We want to know you and be known by you. Amen.